All right, y'all. So my boy is back at it again. For those of you that don't know, I got a source who lives in Cali whose grandfather and father hailed from Mexico. They share stories and they shared their folklore with him. And what he says about the giants, y'all, come on. Here we go. So his grandfather would say that there's five different types of giants that have inhabited Earth. And of these five different types of giants, two were evil. He would explain the largest giants to ever inhabit Earth would walk from land to land through the oceans. The deepest of waters would come up to the majority of their shoulders, but the biggest of all, it would only come up to their waist. His grandfather didn't know much about these giants because they were the oldest. These giants would die off, and there were very few left even before the first Great Earth War. That they were full of energy and they were highly intelligent. So much so that they became one with Mother Nature. That they were pure, nothing but love and light. That they were so in tune with Mother Nature and Mother Earth that upon their deaths, they would become island chains or mountain ranges. Sicilian folklore about giants explained the same thing, but they did have conflicts, and many of those conflicts led to a lot of their demise. The second type of giants and the second tallest ranged from 20 to 40 feet tall. These giants were dumb and generally overweight. Not only would they eat each other, but they would eat humans as well. They would literally destroy everything in their path and were easily manipulated and bribed by evil factions on Earth. His grandfather would say that these giants were clumsy and slow, easily killed by a fast opponent. Literally abominations. This brings us to the third type. The third group of giants were 20 to 30 feet tall. They were blue and they had horns, massive goat horns, and that they loved to party. These giants were good-natured and generally didn't like violence. They were highly intelligent and had the power to heal. They had a few warriors to protect them, but other than that, they were not a violent faction. His grandfather would say that these giants had the sacred knowledge of old. When the Great Earth Wars came, they didn't want to partake and they didn't want to fight, but they would provide healing for the good factions. And their warriors that did fight were super fast and were absolute killing machines. This made me think of Norse mythology and the frost giants of old. But this brings us to the fourth type. The fourth group of giants were 15 to 30 feet tall. They had eagle or reptilian legs, were sometimes green, and had wings. Book of Enoch, anybody? The Fallen? They were so evil, they loved to eat humans, especially offspring. These beings possessed evil magical powers, so much so that when they would walk through Mother Nature, everything around them and behind them would die. They would lure in men and women and control them with their black magic. With their flying abilities, they were a force to be reckoned with. They almost looked angelic. His grandfather would go on to state that they were so evil that they could be killed with water and dirt when shoved in their mouth. That's how out of tune their energy was with Mother Nature. The fifth group of giants were 15 to 30 feet tall. These were our ancient ancestors, and they looked just like us. They were inherently good, and they wanted to help mankind succeed. They hail from all over the world, and they hailed from a time when our ancestors were just actually that tall. At this time, before the Third Earth War, the nations were all love and light. They were in tune with Mother Nature. The Great Flood pushed them into the subterranean pockets, where it is said today, some of them have been kept cryogenically frozen in crystalline-like structures. It's even believed by some that they're awakening today. I hope you enjoyed the video. Come back for more. Like, subscribe, follow, all that good stuff. Love you guys. Peace out. So in the Book of Enoch in chapter 7, it states that the Fallen came down and bred with the daughters of men. They took unto themselves wives and chose one for each himself. And they three became pregnant, and they bare great giants, whose height was 3,000 ells. Now if you don't know what ell means, elbow to hand. That's a unit of measure they used back then. In certain societies, the length an ell represented differed, ranging from what is commonly known as 18 inches. But as I looked it up, the average from the French to the Scottish was well over 2 feet. The Scottish, 54 inches, was an ell. So I've been looking into Norse and Greek mythology, and they talk about Zeus, the son of Cronus. Cronus was a titan, and he ate all of his children in fear that they would overthrow his throne. Cronus's wife, Rhea, grew angry over this, so she decided to take one of his sons and hide him. His name was Zeus, and he was hidden raised on Crete Island. So a while back, I remember doing a video on Crete Island and how there was a lot of giants' remains found there. The remains found ranged anywhere from 40 feet up to 72 feet in length. And I also read that there was a lot of giant activity around Sardinia, so I began looking on Google Earth to check it out. Crete Island, Sardinia. And here's what I found on the ocean floor next to Sardinia. All of these, what look like footsteps. I'm saying if you took a regular person and told them to take steps and multiple steps on the beach in clay or sand and then mimic them, these will line up pretty close to the same steps and foot patterns as what a human would lay. So I humored the idea and thought, well, maybe it was a giant. And here's what I found. Upon zooming in and using the measurement tool on Google Earth, one of those footsteps was 4,625 feet. There's more. And these footprints appeared all over, up the coast of Africa, all through the Mediterranean. You could find these footprints. And what's more amazing, I found some that strided out. Stride 10.4 miles. So I guess what I'm saying is, could these footprints have been left by a titan? Possibly even Cronus. And my boy Mini Minuteman, who criticized me about finding footprints on the ocean floor 2.1 miles deep, no, he didn't need a snorkel. He was over 2 miles tall. And his feet print, much larger than 7 feet. The stories of the Titans, I believe, is true, and they were massive beyond belief. Poseidon, said to be a giant, god of the sea. Could they be his feet print? God of the sea, he could travel through all the oceans without even having to go underwater. Now I know that sounds crazy, but it did say in the Book of Enoch 3,000 ells. When doing the math, that ranged from the smallest 4,500 feet to up to 12,500 feet. So before I continue, smash that like button, hit the bell, and subscribe to my page for more content like this. I know some of the stuff I post can seem far-fetched, but rather than disregard these people that are telling these stories in ancient times as total quacks, why not take them seriously? Why not legitimize them? This is how they knew how to relay what they experienced. Today, if there was a flood, everything would be gone. Everything, record of everything we have. But what would be left? Certain people that lived, that told the legacy on. Through story, around campfires, they would tell these stories of great titans and gods that roamed Earth. They could simply be higher beings, extraterrestrials, or they could be divine, or both. But I think as mankind, we need to stop putting limits on what is possible in this world. The simple notion that Gaia, Mother Nature, creator of all, is a living, breathing organism in itself is absolutely fantastical. Yes, our planet has a consciousness. Our planet is alive. It is a living organism. And when you abuse her and when you treat her like crap, she will fight back. She will preserve her survival, and so will the higher beings. The giants, they were abominations. They were evil, and the sin on Earth was great at these times. The fallen, the watchers, the Anunnaki, much sin, much evil, and that's kind of the way it's going at the moment. She even creates her own organic supercomputer that creates life and influences life, opens the seven chakras, while the evil side send in the same stuff, but it only opens 3 chakras. Head, life, and sexual chakra, instead of all 7. That's why society is going the way it is. Back in Atlantean times, the Atlanteans were persuaded with technology and convinced by evil extraterrestrials, the Anunnaki and the gray aliens. They were convinced to open a portal. And when they opened the stargate in the universe, the Anunnaki and the grays sent in meteors. They were full of the evil black goo and black stones. These evil black stones convince people and sway them towards the evil. That's why it's only 3 chakras, head, life, and sexual chakra. They lose the heart chakra, empathy. And if there's ever been a time where there was lack of empathy, it's now. The story goes, in World War II, the German SS soldier went into a mine shaft and he found these black rocks. They would later find out they were meteorites. He took them back to base where a certain leader came into contact with them, lost all empathy, and wiped out an entire civilization of people. This stuff is real, people. Is here. so open your hearts. U.S. Special Forces encounter giants in Antarctica. You heard it here first. It was the early 2000s, right around the same time as the Kandahar Giant, when a team of Navy SEALs was called to Antarctica. Their mission was to plunge deep into the ice shelf and explore ruins recently discovered by ground-penetrating radar. Upon arrival at the site, they would begin their descent down a large pre-drilled hole that would open up into a cavern. As soon as their boots hit the ground, they would quickly realize the cavern was actually a massive megalithic structure. The structures were thousands of years old, and they believed them to be built by the ancient builder race, the same ones that built the pyramids. Amazed, they began exploring, eventually stumbling upon a large door. One of the SEALs would approach the door and touch it with his hand. To their surprise, it began shifting, almost as if powered by anti-gravity. The 30-foot door would move back and to the side, letting them into the corridor. In utter disbelief, they decide to split up into groups of two. They cautiously make their way around the room, noticing hieroglyphs of which they had never seen before. As they sweep the area, senses heightened, one of the men yells, "Guys, come look at this!" As the rest of the team approaches this portion of the structure, they instantly notice the super advanced tech and their comrades staring at a large crystal chamber. They brush a layer of frost off that has accumulated over thousands of years. And inside, they see it. It's approximately 14 to 16 feet tall, its massive frame towering over the men. Its eyes still open with a fierce look on its face, almost as if it's staring at them. The warm blood running through their veins turns cold. As it is said, when a soldier first experiences these beings, it changes them. They will never be the same, but some take it better than others. It is reported that some soldiers lose their head completely upon sight. They simply cannot handle it. They have to back out. Others' hair has turned completely gray in an instant. They are simply that afraid. As they're pondering over what they're looking at, one of the soldiers says, "Guys, check it out." They look over, and two of the chambers have already been broken through. These crystal chambers had them in stasis, and they are now waking up. That's when the lead SEAL yells out, "All right, fellas, you know what time it is, on me." They hastily start swapping out the clips on their assault rifles. They've come prepared, as if they already knew what they were going to encounter. The rounds in these new magazines were something special. They weren't regular hollow point lead. They were actually made of pure copper. As the military and the Pentagon knew that pure copper is the only thing that kills these beasts. Using anything else is futile and will not hurt them. As they're finally getting locked and loaded, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, they hear a cry. And no sooner do they turn around, one of the beasts flies from behind a megalith. It grabs one of the soldiers and slams him to the ground, killing him instantly. The second beast jumps from a ledge above, landing on another, squishing him to a pulp. "Fire, fire, fire!" They open up. The beasts run through the bullets as if they don't even touch them. The rest of the men scramble to take cover. They slide to cover and look back. They're gone. They move throughout the corridor swiftly and silently. So after shooting the giants with the pure copper rounds, they can tell it had an effect. They were slowed enough for the team to take cover behind a monument. And when they peek back around the edge to see where they're at, the giants are gone. So after taking a moment to gather themselves, they start heading down the opposite direction of the corridor. They stay within cover of the pillars running down the entire walkway, and they cover ground fairly quickly. They've covered probably close to a quarter mile. This cavern is huge. When suddenly they hear the two giants cry out, they turn around and there they stand in the middle of the corridor. They begin trotting towards them and then full on sprint. They're coming for them. The SEALs begin to engage their targets again. This time they don't walk through it. They begin to slow in their run and eventually fall to the ground. The copper rounds work, and before long they're laying there breathless. A sense of relief swarms over the team, but it was short-lived. As soon as the other two dropped, another cry. It was the third giant. It was out of its stasis. "Move, move, move!" The SEALs turn and begin running. They look back, see the giant running towards them, and continue. They can hear his footsteps, and then they just stop, and they turn to see where he's at. He's gone. It seems as if though he's almost playing with his food. They see another large doorway at the end of the hall, probably another quarter mile up. They're glancing around, looking for the giant. They can't see him. Then, as they're passing a section with large monuments on each side, one of the soldiers in the very back lets out a blood-curdling cry. The giant appears as if a blur from one side of the hallway to the other, and on the way through, he grabs another soldier. So he seems preoccupied with the said soldier for a little bit, grabbing his first out-of-stasis meal. The team approaches the doorway, and again, it's being blocked off by a large stone slab. One of the soldiers notices a cutout in the rock wall, and they press it. It begins moving. The giant hears it. He looks up and starts their way, moving swiftly. "Hold him off, fellas, let's go." The team engages the target again. At this point, there's only three or four of them left, and the giant's running through the bullets as if they're nothing. It's not looking good when the group lead throws his gun down and reaches for a pouch on his vest. At this point, the door has finally slid open. It's within feet. They dart through, the lead soldier turns around and chucks a grenade through the doorway. It's full of copper bearings. Take cover! They step behind the wall, the grenade goes off. Dozens of bearings hit the giant, the door slams. They made it. Relieved, they turn around to a massive cave system. They can't believe the size. They figure its total width is a couple miles. It is believed that the giants themselves and whoever created them had bored a tunnel. This tunnel ran from Antarctica all the way up to the Northwest Territories in Canada. They supposedly have a plasma drill that can drill up to 7 miles a day. This is what they use for travel. This large tunnel has smaller tunnels branching off of it, leading through the mountains. Likely where all the missing hikers end up. The soldiers would eventually find their way to the surface, contact command. Most of them never spoke of it again. This is the legend of the Kandahar Giant and his encounter with U.S. Special Forces. It was 2002 in Kandahar during the war in Afghanistan when a U.S. Special Forces unit that specialized in rescue missions was called to duty. Their mission? To find a unit that seemed to have just vanished deep within the mountains. They wasted no time and began moving as they wanted to be back before nightfall. According to an eyewitness that was part of the Special Forces unit, they had trekked 4 miles up the side of the mountain and they were almost to the last pinpointed location of the lost unit when they began finding broken military equipment strewn about all throughout the mountains. That's when they looked up and noticed a massive cave. As they approached the cave, they noticed a rancid smell and began seeing body parts laying all over the ground. When all of a sudden, an 18-foot-tall giant flew out of the cave, spearing one of their men. Stunned, the unit immediately opens fire, letting him have it. He was a monster, the witness explained. You could see in your peripherals the bodies stacked up at the cave entrance. This led us to believe he was a cannibal. With a red beard and scarlet red long hair covering his shoulders, and Dan, whose body lay limp at the end of his spear. As I noticed he had 6 fingers and toes, the lieutenant yells fire, snapping me back to reality. We began shooting the beast, quickly noticing the bullets were having little effect. The beast tosses Dan 30 feet off the end of the spear, as if nothing but a toy. He moved so swiftly, you would never believe he was actually as big as he was. Wielding his spear, he began barreling towards us with bloodthirsty rage on his face. And as if instinct kicked in all at once, we all yelled out, "Aim for the head!" The team was carrying an M4 submachine gun, a .308 sniper rifle, and a Barrett 50 caliber. Within seconds, he fell to the ground lifeless. And the team remembers the day they battled the Kandahar Giant. So as the giant lay there dead, they radio back to base, and a chopper comes and picks it up. It weighed in about 1,200 pounds. This beast had a total of 12 fingers and 12 toes. And by witness account, it smelled like it hadn't bathed in probably 10 years. Nasty. And of course, standard procedure as they got back to the base, they made him sign a hush-hush agreement, stating that the world wasn't ready for this info. The witness who shared this story felt that the people should know, and that there was no reason to keep us in the dark. At the end of the day, I know this is hard for some of you to believe, but giants have been in our history since the Bible, the biblical days. The Nephilim are fallen angels that came down and bred with humans. This enhanced our race. That being said, I ain't telling you, you gotta believe shit. Believe what you want. And one guy promised he was 22 feet as well. His body is in Ohio. Tune in next time. In 2014, there was a lawsuit filed against the Smithsonian Museum. It alleged that they have been withholding, even destroying evidence that giants ever existed on this planet. The Supreme Court ruled that they declassified documents back to 1900. Here's some of what they released. Reported back in 2015, a large giant was unearthed in Australia. It was said that this is the world's largest giant ever unearthed. Found near Ayers Rock, the skeleton is said to be 17 feet 4 inches tall. But shortly after unearthing, Professor Hans Zimmer was forced to hand it over to the government, and there has been no further reporting since. The next giant takes us to Pennsylvania. Reported in the Oil City Times in 1870 near West Hickory, Pennsylvania, the unearthing of arguably the largest giant ever found. This massive hominid stood at 18 feet tall. On October 7th, 1895, a newspaper named The World reported that one of the largest giants ever unearthed had been found. The mummified remains stood 9 feet tall. Could the recent discovery of a massive fossilized skull rewrite human history as we know it? The specimen found was allegedly wrapped up and placed in an abandoned well over 90 years ago. The skull, which you see here, was originally discovered in 1933 by Chinese laborers building a bridge over the Songgao River in Harbin, which is located in China's northernmost province, Heilongjiang. At the time of the discovery, this area of China was under Japanese occupation. So to keep it from falling into the wrong hands, they wrapped it up and placed it in an abandoned well. It would resurface in 2018, only after the man who hid it told his grandson on his deathbed about it. Shortly after retrieving the unique specimen, the grandson would turn it into the proper authorities for research. They estimate this massive humanoid roamed the Earth 140,000 to 300,000 years ago. What makes it unique is that it contains characteristics of both primitive and modern humans. So could this rewrite the history of mankind? Isn't it obvious what took place? Check out the skulls above me. You have the skull of a modern human, a Neanderthal, and a Denisovan. This skull was recently pulled out of a well in China. Scientists are baffled because it has characteristics of humans and Neanderthals. And its cranium, which is the housing of the brain, is 9 inches long and 6 inches wide. So it's slightly elongated. So the Book of Enoch says what? God smited the fallen angels for coming down to earth and influencing humans negatively. So it hit me. Could the elongated skull people be the fallen angels? Could they have come down from the skies and bred with mankind? To me, it looks like a resounding yes. They came from the skies, bred with Neanderthals, you get Denisovans, who also became giants. And I believe where they came from is possibly Mars, the red planet with no water. They ravaged their planet with nuclear war and space jumped to Earth. It is said to be known by locals as the place of the giants since its discovery in 2002 by the Pentagon using geodesic satellite radar. They discovered large caverns cut right into the side of a mountain with no visible entrances at the surface. They were beings that seemed to have mastered technologies even more advanced than today's. The walls of these tunnels were smooth like polished marble. They start in the mountain at an even slope and then make a cut at a perfect 26 degree angle. This would lead up to a central room with a height of 30 meters tall and 100 meters wide. Lined up along both the left and the right walls were tables with a height of no less than 6 feet. On these tables were all types of ancient cuneiform writing, while there were some that were more familiar, like circles and triangles. On other tables, there seemed to be some sort of consoles with all sorts of cables coming out of them. These consoles could design holographic images based on scientific information. Welcome to the Buzeci Mountains of Romania. This is Sarah Winnemucca's detailed account of the Paiute tribe of Nevada's encounter with the red-haired giants of North America. The Paiute people would refer to them as Sateca, meaning tule eaters. Tule is a water plant that grows in the marshes across North America. They would then use this plant to weave large rafts of which they would navigate Humboldt Lake with. They would also use them to flee surprise attacks from the Paiute people. And lastly, they would use them to capture the Paiute women as they gathered tule near the lake. Her chronicle states that after 3 years of blood-weary battles, a coalition of regional tribes would finally gather to take on this savage enemy. The allied tribes finally bravely pushed the giants back into the Lovelock Caves. Then they would quickly cover the entrance with brush piles and set them ablaze. The giants would suffocate and any escapees would get bombarded with arrows. This would be the last of the red-haired giants. It's said that this dress, which is one of a kind, is made out of the red-haired giant's hair.
Alright fam, you're gonna want to hear this one. A couple days ago, a soldier with the highest security clearance sent me a message on my TikTok. In his message, he would state that he might know why Biden left Afghanistan the way he did. Intrigued, I said, please explain. He disclosed that he had top secret security clearance and that it was his second tour in Afghanistan. He was a radio technician and he would fix the broken comms soldiers would bring back to the FOB, or the forward operating base. While in the Middle East, he would work with the best spec ops teams in the military. From MARSOC, which is US Marine Corps Special Forces, to the SEALs, the Rangers, and the British Marines. And about 7 months ago is when he got back from his last tour. It was around the time that Biden first took office, and the same time when something would take place that made US forces decide it wasn't worth being there. And here is why, viewer discretion advised. He was nearing the end of his tour when one of his SEAL buddies brought back a bunch of broken radios. After a mission where his team would take on 60% casualties, which was highly unusual in Afghanistan at this time. And they had been sent out on a patrol in the surrounding hills and mountains. They were in the Kandahar region of Afghanistan. Officially, his buddy would tell him they got attacked by a platoon-sized element of the Taliban. But for some reason, he could sense that he wasn't hearing the entirety of the story. Well, lucky for our technician, he had recently snuck booze into the wire. And he would end up getting drunk with the SEAL team member for 6 nights straight. And on the very last night of drinking together, the SEAL team member, out of the blue, would say, "You can't tell anybody about this." And the shit he's about to say should never be repeated. Our whistleblower would explain that the SEAL team member wouldn't go into gritty detail. He assumed it was either because he hadn't processed it yet, or someone forcibly told him not to tell a soul. During the mission, we would come up on a cave that was supposed to be a hostile outpost. But as they approached the outpost in the cave, they suddenly heard screaming inside. They then proceeded to a vantage point where they could get a better view, out of sight of any enemy combatants. When they finally got in position and glanced down into the cave, they couldn't believe their eyes. It was a giant standing anywhere from 16 to 20 feet tall, fighting the Taliban. he was crushing them limb from limb, tossing them around like rag dolls, killing one after another after another. The men were in shock. They couldn't believe what they were witnessing. They would watch for about 30 seconds and then decide it would be smart to take a tactical withdrawal. But as they were backing up, the giant would spot one of them. And with swift speed, he would pursue and be on top of them in seconds. He would engage and kill three of them immediately. So quickly, one of them called air support from an A-10. By the time the bombs buried the beast, he killed 8 SEALs and corpsmen, wounding 2, but they survived. They were told to keep quiet because of backlash. Shortly after this incident, we would decide to make a hasty withdrawal. This would be the second time U.S. soldiers would battle a giant from Kandahar.
This clip is said to be a giant. This was filmed somewhere in the Middle East, and if you take a good look, this giant was standing next to a tank. It's now looked like it's disappearing into the ground. We're gonna play it again. Tell me what you think. Compare the size of the giant to the tank. I can't help but to think of Night God 333 posting recently more sightings of the Kandahar giant and a possible reason why we could have left Afghanistan.